This is North Dakota Legislative Review. I'm Dave Thompson. Thanks for joining us today. The legislature has received its new update of revenue forecast. Some good news for the state of North Dakota. More money is available. And here to talk about that and some of the spending issues and some of the other issues that are reaching the legislature as it climaxes toward the crossover date is the Assistant House Minority Leader, Lee Kaldor from Mayville. Representative, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me, Dave.
You're on the Appropriations Committee, too, so you heard the report from the consultants and $47 million more on the bottom line.
Yes, we did. That was reported on Monday morning, and it's a favorable report. It gives a strong indication of where we're headed, and it was actually very positive for us to see.
You know, in earlier sessions, if you would have had a consultant say you have $47 million more on the bottom line, there would have been lawmakers doing cartwheels coming out of the meeting. It kind of, okay, that's fine, but, you know, with the state with a pretty big surplus right now, it didn't make that much of an impact.
It probably didn't on the surface. I think there was an expectation that it might be even higher than that amongst several legislators, and there are some questions about how the forecast was actually arrived at. There is a forecast advisory committee that OMB has that actually goes through Moody's report and extrapolates from that to give some guidance in the forecast, besides the tax information that they also collect. You know, they kept the oil production and the oil price at the level that they put in the November forecast, and even at this date, the oil prices are higher than the forecast, and the production is a little bit better than it was then too. So not adjusting for that had some effect.
In terms of how it's going to affect budget decisions now, what kind of effect will it have as you start kicking out some of the budget bills?
I think the effect, Dave, right now is pretty negligible, because when you start to look at the full line of things that we're dealing with, just in the past couple of days, we passed $150 million in income tax, both corporate and individual relief, and that becomes an expenditure, a removal from the general fund revenues that we would ordinarily get. And we've got any number of spending bills that are on the table that are still being digested by the Appropriations Committee. So there's a lot of uncertainty yet as to what will, you know, finally come out of all of this. So the forecast gives us a little bit more confidence, but it doesn't really lead us to say, well, we can spend $47 million more dollars, or we've got a bigger cushion now. It's probably not that influential on the process.
You and some of your colleagues on the Democratic side of the aisle were kind of arguing against the tax breaks, basically saying, and we're talking about tax reductions in income tax and corporate tax. You were saying it was premature. If I remember, I think that was your argument.
Dave, I did make that argument on the floor, and mainly from the premise that historically, when we've talked about what I was relating to was spending bills, we've had several initiatives, and this goes over several sessions, for example, measures to spend more on infrastructure and roads. And they're almost always dispatched at this time of the session because it's premature. We should wait and see where we're going to be at towards the end of the session before we decide on things like that. I think we had time. You know, unfortunately, all of the tax bills, even the ones that Democrats proposed, the tax reductions were all brought together in the same day. Democrats have been desiring to focus our attention on working families. Even the report from Moody's indicated that low to moderate income tax relief is much more stimulative than any other tax relief. The income tax measure that was passed on the floor this week really takes out some of the progressivity that's even in the governor's measure. The governor's $50 million income tax reduction is a static numeric reduction in each rate class, so it remains progressive. What was done in the Republican bill that passed the House is actually a percentage decrease for each rate class, which means that the tax benefits skew much more heavily towards the high income levels, where Moody's suggested, we don't find much stimulative effect from that. You put the put these dollars in the pockets of working families, and it'll get returned and revolved in the community.
I was kind of interested that there was not much discussion about the $50 million corporate tax package. Of course, there was a long discussion about the income tax package, but then the corporate tax package came up, and there wasn't a lot of discussion about that.
I think the probably the feeling was that the debate had been held on the priorities in the first bill. The corporate income tax reduction is a straight, I mean, the first $75,000 of income for a corporation would be tax exempt, and that would be net income. And if you recall, Representative Kelsch had a bill, an individual income tax reduction that would have exempted the first $40,000 of single and $50,000 of married filing jointly income. We felt it was better to return the tax breaks to individuals. We didn't see any need to stimulate further corporate tax reductions at this time, as they're already doing quite well in North Dakota. And to be frank about it, I've yet to hear one constituent tell me that we needed a corporate tax decrease.
Now, the governor's proposal, $50 million on the income tax, is pending in the Senate. It's going to be part of a package, I think, that Senate Appropriations is working on. Do you think there's a lot of appetite in the Senate for a $100 million income tax increase, or decrease, I should say, and a $50 million corporate tax decrease?
Well, I don't know. Talking to some of the senators, they're concerned about it. Some are wondering whether or not they should pass the governor's measure or defeat the governor's measure and have the House measures come over and debate them. I'm hopeful that we reconcile this, and, you know, at the end of the session. I would rather see the Senate pass the governor's measure and send it to the House so that we've got both of these measures, one on each side, to reconcile near the end. It'll all come down to what we can afford to do, and tax cuts are also expenditures when you consider the revenue and expenditures of the state. So they all need to be reconciled with the spending priorities.
I didn't want to spend that much time on this, but there's one other question I wanted to ask you, because mm-hmm. you had mentioned in your floor speech that there were cuts or reductions in what Governor Dalrymple had proposed. They're coming down the pike. What so far has the committee talked about?
Well, we're just in the preliminary stages. In fact, later today we'll be talking about some of these budgets, some of the agency budgets. But I'll give you one, for example, that we dealt with this morning, the Highway Patrol budget. The governor had put three FTEs, three basically Highway Patrolmen added into his budget, and we, in the Appropriations Committee, removed those three FTEs, which amounts to about $600,000+ of cost. It may seem like a small thing. It's one of those things that comes to the floor, and of course the debate will be, well, we reduced the increase, but in reality, this is an actual cut. There'll be three fewer highway patrolmen on the highways if this bill passes, as compared to what we had in the 2009-11 session. Another example I'll give you, the Indian Affairs Commission came in with their budget. The governor had proposed $100,000 for suicide prevention program planning. We cut that by $50,000. Again, it seems very trivial, but these are the kinds of things that you see, and the language the debate that goes on is, well, we can't afford to do all these things. We've got to cut back some degree. We will see, I think, many examples of that across the board. And of course, it's probably a futile debate. But the point is, the governor's budget is, as we've said, the Democrats have said, it's responsible, and we're only asking for justification for the cuts that are being made in his budget. And most of the time, those justifications aren't very clear.
So we should explain, though, appropriations is three subcommittees, three permanent subcommittees. And you are on which one?
I'm on the Human Resources Subcommittee in the House.
So you haven't got a chance to look at what Representative Scarpole has proposed for higher education yet?
I have not. We're expecting that soon, very soon.
But you've heard what could or could not be in it.
Yes, I have.
It seems like higher education is kind of a target this session. Am I wrong in that perception?
No, I think your perception is correct. Part of it, I think, comes from some of the things that occurred over the interim or over the past couple of years. We've had the president's house at NDSU and some serious expenditure issues that legislators have had a lot of trouble with, and so there's been this maybe to some degree a mistrust. And I think what's happening now, you see legislators focusing and more, trying to control more. We had a bill the other day where the legislature would set tuition for the institutions of higher education. So I think your perception is correct. I think it's unfortunate. And of course, some of the things that I'm seeing, that being proposed at least, reductions in tuition assistance, basically the funding to the universities that would mitigate the need to raise tuition, that's been cut so that tuition increases on the campuses would be higher than they were under the governor's budget. The STEM education base funding, which is for our four-year institutions to focus on science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, crucial issue nationwide, worldwide, and they've proposing cutting that out of the budget as well. So those are some things that we'll resist. I think they're not well thought out at this point in time.
There was one other thing that caught me, and it kind of caught me by surprise, because there seemed to be at least some kind of, for lack of a better term, gentleman's agreement about the library at Dickinson State, and I understand that's at least being proposed to be removed.
It is, as I understand it. I haven't seen the specific amendments, but I've seen the report on what the House Education and Environment Committee put out. They show the Stockson Library as being removed from the budget, and as we recall, that was included in last session's budget. It was not a top priority in the Board of Higher Ed's list, but it was passed by the legislature with a contingent appropriation. There was a little debacle over that.
Yeah.
Our treasurer had a little trouble figuring out what was in the checkbook, and what happened was, as you recall, they had to suspend that. They couldn't execute on that appropriation because we didn't have enough funds in the general fund. And so there was a commitment made, at least as I recall it, by then Governor Hoban, that we would do this session, and it was in the budget. But the committee has pulled it out. I don't know the reasons for that. I have not heard, but they've reprioritized some of the building projects.
Do you think that some of these things that are being done are bargaining chips?
Oh, this is what we talk about in committee. I've had it described to me by the majority sometimes as this is an exercise, and we're going to do this because we know that this will come to conference committee at the end of the session. So yes.
So there are, we're preliminary at this point. There still has to be full committee markup. There has to be,
yes,
a floor debate. It has to go to the other chamber, and eventually is going to end up in probably a conference committee.
I don't think there's any question. Higher education always ends up in a conference committee. So does primary and secondary education. So does human services. The Department of Health. All the large budgets ultimately end in conference committee negotiations.
Yet on elementary and secondary education, there seems to have been general agreement that there should be continuation of funding at 70% state support for the K-12 education.
As I understand it, that is true. There are some changes that have been made. As you might recall, there was a merit teacher pay component in the primary K-12 education plan for this session, and it looks as though that is being probably put on hold or put into a study. And there are several other changes. I'm not privy to all of them because I don't serve on that committee, but school districts are having some concerns about how this will be implemented.
Yeah. Well, since we're talking about some spending things, thinking back to 2 years ago, there was a fight over the tobacco settlement money.
Yes.
And you were in the middle of that.
I was.
And here we go again. There's a proposal to take that money and put it toward a new medical school building at UND, along with some of the training programs for rural doctors. It passed the policy committee. Now it's in front of your committee.
Yes, 1353 is the bill that you're speaking of, and it takes the trust fund that's established with the Tobacco Prevention and Control Fund that was passed by the voters in 2008. It basically turns that trust fund into a health trust fund from which anything can be funded. And in this particular case, they're using the dollars to fund a medical school addition and a program enhancement for primary care physicians and also for a master's program in public health with NDSU. And there's no question we have a need in North Dakota for primary care physicians, and we have a need for public health professionals across the state. However, what they're doing by taking Measure 3, they're in conflict with the will of the people on that vote, and they're creating what I think is going to be a very stormy discussion. And it may not be helpful to the medical school in the long run to have this debate.
The perception is that the medical school may be caught in the middle of this whole thing. It's pushed this initiative. It wants to train more doctors, basically, and help out in the rural areas. And the medical school dean has said that he really doesn't care where the money comes from. He would like to see this happen because he sees a need.
No question. He's committed to the fulfilling the need. And that's a positive thing. I'm disappointed that he's less concerned about where the money comes from, because even in the advisory council book that was published, which justifies the need for the medical school, they talk a great deal about prevention and behavior changes as so being so important to our health care. And you know, the old axiom, prevention is worth a an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, really speaks most appropriately to what Measure 3 says, and that is that we should spend tobacco money on tobacco prevention and control.
Not to put too fine a point on it, it does take a two-thirds vote, does it not?
Yes, it does. Yeah. And of course, that's the people's saving grace. When they pass an initiated measure, I believe it's 7 years. I'm not sure what the timeline is. I can't recall.
I think 7 years is correct.
7 years. Within that time period, the legislature needs a two-thirds vote to change the measure. So anything we do relative to Measure 3 will require that two-thirds vote.
So they've got a lot of heavy lifting yet in appropriations, but then again, you knew the job was dangerous when you took it.
I guess I did. Yeah, but you're right. A lot of heavy lifting left to do.
I've got a couple of things about policy issues that are mm-hmm. going to be coming up. We're going to probably see a vote in the next couple of days on the UND Fighting Sioux nickname. One bill came out of the Education Committee that basically says it will be the Fighting Sioux. The other two had some language in there about Standing Rock, and Standing Rock has not taken a vote on this. I'm going to put you on the spot. How do you come down on that bill?
I will be voting against the bill. I love the Fighting Sioux, I love UND, and at the same time, I appreciate the concerns of those in our Native American community who are concerned about this and feel offended by it. It's hard for me to put myself in their place. I can't really do that. But when they say that it is of harm to them, the use of the word, then I have to respect that. But even beyond that, if you look at what the Board of Higher Education did in this process, how they attempted to preserve the logo in this whole process, I think they did everything they could to preserve it and protect it. And the NCAA is an association. It's a private association. We can either belong or we don't have to belong. We play by their rules. And so I'm not so sure what value is brought by instituting this logo into our statute and nickname. I think it's a mistake to do this. I understand people's passions on both sides, but I think that it's time to move on.
Is there not a constitutional problem with the bill too?
I believe there is a constitutional problem because the Board of Higher Ed has primacy over this issue. They are the constitutionally recognized organization that is responsible for management of the institutions of higher education. So we're interceding on their territory.
That will come up for a vote in the next day, maybe early next week.
It certainly, if it's not tomorrow, it'll be sometime early next week, I think.
In the few minutes we have left, I want to get into an issue that's actually going to be more prevalent for you in November, and that's the whole issue of redistricting and mm-hmm. reapportionment. Have you got any thoughts about where you'd like to see things happen? Is the legislature the right size now? Does it need to be increased or does it need to be cut a bit?
I don't really have an opinion on the size. I think right now one could argue that it's an appropriate size based on the way our representation is done. It would be easy to add two districts because of the demographics of North Dakota, and we would minimize the impact that we're going to have on rural districts, making them grow even larger. And I think those things will be considered in this process. It's going to be really interesting because we've got a whole new set of legislators that have been elected. It'll be a little bit more complicated to draw lines probably than it has been in the past. Reducing the size of the legislature, I think, is problematic because some of these districts are so large. I think one of our western districts would be larger than the state of Rhode Island if we reduced by a district or two. So I'm not so sure that that'll happen.
Also coming up in that session, it looks like some of the health care decisions may be delayed until that time. Mm-hmm. For example, the idea of setting up the health care exchanges, the things that Insurance Commissioner Adam Hamm has talked about. Do you see any problems with that, or is that going to be a really probably intense debate?
I don't know how intense the debate will be. I think the premise is that we'll have to set one up if it comes to that point, and we need to know more firmly what the rules are. We're still learning what the rules are. I don't know that allocating time in that special session for the healthcare debate is absolutely necessary, but I'm not going to suggest that we shouldn't be talking about it. We probably have to.
Would you have preferred that you make decisions now in a general full session?
That would always be preferable if we could do it in a full session like we are in now. But I understand and respect the some of the challenges that they face relative to rules and rulemaking. There it does seem to be, though, a little bit of resistance, kind of a wait and see what the Supreme Court does approach to this, because maybe we won't have to do this. And my inclination is that there will be some form of health care reform that will meet constitutional muster, and that we should be preparing as best we can for the health care exchanges, the insurance exchanges, and get as ready as we can be now.
Of course, it's, as you said, it's still in the courts, and the next court decision may shed some light, but it's probably a safe bet it's going to the Supreme Court.
I think it is, and of course North Dakota is in a lawsuit. We're one of the plaintiffs in these suits, so that makes it a little bit more complicated for those of us who felt that health care reform was needed. This obviously complicates the issue.
Just a very brief answer. Is there some issue that is making you scratch your head right now?
Well, I in a general sense, I'm scratching my head over our attitude towards local government. We seem to have a number of bills that where the legislature is intervening in local government's decision-making process, how they tax, how they report, how they levy their taxes and such. So yes.
Okay. We could talk about that for a long time.
Yeah, we could.
We have come to the end of the half hour. Thank you for being with us.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you.
Our guest today, Mayville Representative Lee Kaldor. He's the assistant floor leader for the minority in the House. For Legislative Review and for Prairie Public, I'm Dave Thompson.